Has Ved ma'am joined?
So I can see ma'am's name. I think she must have joined, sir.
Professor Ved, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Lakshmi sir has joined.
Good afternoon, sir. Yes,
Vesh
I'm
can.
on.
Vesh.
Himanshu Da has messaged. He said that Ved Kumari ma'am will be joining soon.
Hello.
हेलो,
नमस्कार।
गुड आफ्टरनून
नमस्कार मैम। लक्ष्मी
नमस्कार।
जी,
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम, गीतांजलि।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
नाइस टू सी यू।
सेम हियर। आई वांट टू सी द बेबी आल्सो। हेलो। बच्चों की कॉन्फ्रेंस है तो बच्चे तो होने चाहिए।
जी मैं इसीलिए लेके आई हूँ।
इसको तो कुछ समझ नहीं आने वाला।
यंगेस्ट पार्टिसिपेंट मैम।
जी रजिस्ट्रेशन कराई थी। नाम देख लो
अभी तक आधार नहीं बनाया ना इसलिए नहीं किया Swarna, would you please start?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all on behalf of the Center for Child Rights, Naluja, in this lecture on the topic Juvenile Justice Act 2015, Implication and Efficacy. Children's rights are human rights that are accustomed explicitly to children's needs, wants, and overall well-being. They take into account their fragility, specificities, and age-appropriate requirements. Children's rights aim to take into account the necessity of the development of a child. We here at Naluja believe that all children deserve equality despite their difference. They're entitled to all of these rights, no matter what race, color, religion, language, ethnicity, gender, or abilities define them. Our Center for Child Rights has organized a lecture on the topic Juvenile Justice Act 2015, Implication and Efficacy as a part of our lecture series. For this themed occasion, we have among us two of the most decorated names in the field of juvenile justice in our country, Mr. Lakshmi Narayan Nanda and Professor Ved Kumari. But before welcoming our chief guest, I would like our respected Vice Chancellor, Sir, Dr. V.K. Ahuja, to give his welcome speech. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Swarna. Respected Professor Ved Kumari, Honorable Vice Chancellor, NLU Odisha, Dr. Madhulika Jonathan,
so we lost you.
We have to protect them from physical, mental, and sexual exploitation. We have to reform them wherever required, and we have to do their all-round development. UNICEF, being a UN agency, is involved in this important work. Since this is our first collaborative event after I took over as Vice Chancellor of National Law University, Assam, I thought that let us start with a program inviting Professor Ved Kumari, a renowned scholar, and my former boss and colleague at University of Delhi. It is always pleasant listening to her. I welcome you, Professor Ved Kumari.
Thank you.
I also welcome Shri Lakshmi Narayan Nanda, and we had a couple of meetings before this program, and I met him for the very first time in Guwahati only at the NLU. A very good person, excellent human being. And what we have now decided that we will go ahead with many more academic activities in the Assam, where we will not only be targeting the area of Assam, but we will also be focusing on the other states in the Northeast. With these words, I welcome Lakshmi Narayan Nandaji. I welcome all my respected teachers. I can see Professor S.K. Bhatnagar also. Sir, namaskar.
Namaskar, namaskar. Thank you. Good afternoon.
Namaskar, sir. I welcome all my respected teachers and all participants and my dear students. Thank you very much. Over to you, Swarna.
Thank you, sir. It is our utmost pleasure to have amongst us the much revered Vice Chancellor of NLU Odisha, Professor Ved Kumari, and Mr. Lakshmi Narayan Nanda. We feel honored to have esteemed dignitaries like yourselves to grace the noble cause of event which we have organized. Without further ado, I would like to humbly invite to bestow us with invite them to bestow us with all their pearls of wisdom and grace. Mr. Lakshmi Narayan Nanda is an established, passionate, and recognized development professional for 25 years. He has progressive experience of leadership. He possesses a combination of grassroots and senior management experience in social development sector. Sir is professionally trained expert, having solid practical experience on the application of advanced human rights programming tools, and more specifically on child rights and women's rights. He has proven track record of implementing legislative and policies framework, and is champion on promoting and protection of rights of children and associated international protocols. Currently, he is serving as child protection specialist based in Guwahati, covering Assam and other northeastern states. In past, Mr. Lakshmi Narayan Nanda had served organizations such as UNDP, Room to Read, Save the Children, and IIRM, where he played leadership roles, established a state chapter for Room to Read and IIRM, and led a multidisciplinary team in different contexts, including emergencies. His core areas include both managerial and technical leadership for managing high-value state government partners, including the judiciary, legislators, human rights bodies, academia, and civil society organizations. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much for such comprehensive, you know, introduction. I'm a little nervous now, you know, after hearing, you know, such comprehensive, you know, introduction. Without wasting my time, let me just quickly start my deliberation. Respected Dr. V.K. Ahuja, Vice Chancellor, National Law University and Judicial Academy, Assam. Respected Professor Dr. Ved Kumari, Vice Chancellor, National Law University, Odisha, and today's chief speakers and today's deliberation, Juvenile Justice and Care and Protection Act 2015. Distinguished senior faculty of law university, student, legal practitioners, and the representative from other institutions. At the outset, let me take this opportunity to thank Dr. Ahuja and his teams, especially Dr. Nandarani, Dr. Himanshu, and Dr. Gitanjali for taking lead and organizing this lecture series. I'm thankful to Madam Professor Dr. Ved Kumari for her time and agreeing to grace the occasion. As far as today's subject is concerned, she is the authority and someone who closely involved and observed the evolution of JJ system in India since mid-18. Her books and encourage to, you know, refer her books in your work. So that will give much insights about the journey of juvenile justice in India. It gives me immense pleasure to be with you all and share my thoughts on behalf of UNICEF. And I have been assigned to highlight the role of UNICEF in protection and promotion of child rights, which itself is a quite comprehensive and quite details. And let me see how best I can give justice to this. As you know, UNICEF believes all children have the right to survive, thrive, and fulfill their potential. Globally, UNICEF works in 190 countries, some of the world's toughest places to reach world's most disadvantaged children. In India, UNICEF is committed to continue its support to the government in this extraordinary journey of development to reach every child everywhere. So that's the, you know, tagline, every child everywhere in all situations, you know, whether it is emergency, whether it is normal situation or conflict situation, you name it. So our mandate is to be there with the government. We work with different partners and bring them on board and try to facilitate the dialogue between both the right holder and the duty bearers together. To achieve this, we use our technical expertise together with our esteemed partners like this. You know, we have this non-financial but more technical collaboration with academic institutions like Law University, where we try to bring all the actors together and create this platform to share knowledge with larger audience so that, you know, each one can take a lead role in our respective field. UNICEF child protection works include strengthening child protection systems in India, which is relatively new, I would say rather, you know, 10, 15 years old only, addressing some of the specific issues such as child marriage. As you know, that NFHS data, five data, gives us a different figure, very disturbing figure, like the state like Assam, some of the districts where 50% of girls are getting married before the legal age, which is quite disturbing strength. UNICEF also work in the area of strengthening family-based care, child labor, violence against children, and gender-based violence. And the recently emerged topping in the context of pre-COVID is the mental health and psychosocial support. UNICEF focuses on implementation of key child protection legislation and promotion of practices. This area particularly gives us an opportunity to work with judiciary, legislator, and executives on a single point agenda and the promotion and protection of rights of children. As you all know that UNCRC, if I, let me just cite here, if you look at our UNCRC document, out of 54 articles, 29 articles are directly linked with protection rights of children. So this gives us a mandate, and also, you know, I would like to place here that how important it is for all of us to think about how do we protect the rights of children in different sphere within our given mandate. Prevention is the central thing when we address this program in our context. So prevention of rights of children, and through various mechanisms, through various structure that we work at, both at starting from the community to the national level. UNICEF works with a government academic institution, particularly in the area of knowledge management, skill development, civil society organization, creating model and evidence, with judiciary on you know, law implementation, improving quality of monitoring, with legislator, like here in Odisha, we work, in Assam, we work with standing committee for Assam Legislative Assembly, Speaker's Office. In Odisha also, past, I work with the young legislators on promotion of rights of children. So with this, I'd like to stop here, the vast work that UNICEF has been doing in past 75 years in India, and wishing you all the best, and let's listen from ma'am about this journey of the Juvenile Justice Act. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the edifying speech. Now I'd like to welcome our chief guest, Professor Ved Kumari. Professor Ved Kumari is former Dean and Head Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. She began teaching law in 1983 and has taught graduate and undergraduate courses in the University of Delhi, Jammu University in India, and Vanderbilt University, USA, supervised LLM dissertations and PhD thesis. She has written many books and innumerable articles in national and international journals. Professor Ved Kumari's areas of primary academic interest are juvenile justice, criminal law, gender discrimination, clinical education, judicial training. Her greatest contribution is in the field of juvenile justice in India. Her dissertation on rehabilitation process in juvenile correctional institutions in Delhi in 1980 was the first empirical dissertation by a law student, de facto guided by Professor Upendra Bakshi. Her first book, Treatise on the Juvenile Justice Act 1986, published by the Indian Law Institute in 1993, is a pioneering book on the subject and has been referred to as the Bible in the field of juvenile justice by the social activists working with children. Her later books have been well received by the legal and social work fraternity alike. Her latest contribution on the subject is her book, Critical Analysis of Juvenile Justice Act 2015 in the year 2017. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And I do hope that we'll have a quick conversation on this subject. As you're aware, you may not be aware, I don't do lectures very often. I do more conversations. And therefore, my starting point is going to be, tell me, is anyone out of the 260 people we have here, anybody is a child? If you're a child, please raise, you know, kind of made a noise, raise your hand or do something to let us know that you are a child. If nobody's raising a hand, how many times have you heard Professor Ahuja call you child? बच्चे आ रहे हैं कैंपस पे, बच्चे नहीं आ रहे हैं, बच्चों की मेल आई है. सो वॉट इज दैट? आर यू चाइल्ड, आर यू नॉट अ चाइल्ड? शुड यू हैव द सेम रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी एज व्हाट वी कॉल अबाउट प्रोटेक्शन ऑफ चिल्ड्रन और नॉट? क्या कहते हैं? सो शुड वी स्टॉप प्रोफेसर आहूजा टू कॉल यू चाइल्ड और शुड यू एग्री दैट यू आर चाइल्ड? क्या कहते हैं बताओ भाई? स्वर्णा,
I'm not quite sure about
Thank
you,
my mom.
Who said, speak to your mom? Why are you not sure? What are you not sure about? I'm opening the chat box to see what's being written. Okay, Yogiraj is saying that Yogiraj has written, we are child, but not juvenile. Anyone who has been a juvenile? I had my farewell very recently, and my professor, Professor Bakshi, who was mentioned in my introduction, said, I've always called her juvenile. Just her writing on juvenile delinquency, she herself is a juvenile. So anyone who believes you have ever been a juvenile? That's where the whole problem on implementation and efficacy starts. We believe juvenile is person, okay, Rishika is more informed. All of us are juvenile. Okay, that's not the right answer, Rishika, though. Child, as per Indian status, who is not attained the age of 14, that's not true also. Less than 18 years is a child, have been. Rishika says she has been, that's correct. We all have been juvenile because the definition, legal definition of juvenile says persons below the age of 18 years. I'm quite sure all of us were at some point of time below the age of 18 years. So by the legal definition, we were juvenile. But why do we not think of that? Because our mental image of a juvenile or interpretation of the word juvenile is that it's a person who has been found to have committed an offense. But that's not what the legal definition is. There's a perception difference between what people think is a juvenile and what the law uses the term for. And that nuance, the social baggage the term has, impact the children who are found to be in conflict with law. Today, we do not have the term juvenile in the Juvenile Justice Act. There's a definition of juvenile, but there's nothing else happening about juvenile. It's only children in conflict with law. So if I was to ask you that, have you ever been a CCL? Our answer could have been no. But if I ask you a question, have you ever been a juvenile? You can't say no. None of us can say no. We were all juveniles. So that's the kind of, for me, it's very important to notice, you know, to kind of notify us that what in our head is the image of a child. And how is the image of a child different from the image of a juvenile? Even though the legally speaking, both the terms have the same meaning. Child and juvenile both are defined as persons below the age of 18, but in our mind it is different. So I want you to very quickly think of whenever you thought you were a child, but today people were a little, Swarna says she wasn't clear on the answer. But I'm quite sure that you have some understanding of when you were a child. So whenever you were a child, can you think of a memory of that childhood? What was exciting about your childhood? One incident. You have to think about it. I'm not asking me to ask you to narrate that incident. But just identify when you had a lot of thrill, a lot of excitement, something very remarkable about that particular incident in your childhood, which stands out in your memory. I give you 30 seconds to think about that. In the meanwhile, I'm going to put my presentation here. So after that, I'm going to return to you to ask the question, to return back to my question. So let me just share the PPT. Is it available in the presentation form?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so let me come back to you on the question I'm asking you. I'm asking you the question. I want some people to raise their hands to tell me, have you got a memory of your childhood? Okay, you have, good. So when you thought of your memory as a child, no, I'm not asking you to return to tell us about your memory. I want you to write down in the chat box, how old were you? The memory that you thought about. How old were you? What was your age? Were you less than 5 years? Were you between 5 to 10 years? Were you 8 years, 9 years, 12 years, 14 years? Whatever was your age. So far, I have not seen anybody saying I was 17 years old when this happened. Law says you were a child, you are a child till the age of 18. So that the first problem that arises in the implementation of this legislation. Jainab, you want to say something? Yeah, it's not 6, 7, 8. Usually people go up to 14 sometime. But very exceptionally, I would find one person who is very aware of what I'm going to go next. They'll say I was 17. But at 17, did you think of yourself as child? You don't know, I'm adult, I'm bade ho gaye. You didn't want to agree, you know, to obey your parents' directions, like to move here and there. So, yeah, we all wanted to be doing. Yes. Somebody wants to say something? We were called adolescent. The Juvenile Justice Act doesn't make a difference between the two. But when you were adolescent, were you treated like adolescent or were you treated like children? You said, I want to go for a party. The parents said, nahi, nahi, raat ho jayegi, nahi jana hai. Ladkon ke saath nahi jana hai. Agar raat ko jana hai, toh go take somebody along with you. There were all kind of restrictions. You were claiming your adulthood in adolescence. You wanted to, how many of you felt like driving with speed, whatever vehicle you had? How many of you drove before the age of 18? You were actually, at that point of time, juvenile delinquent, even though you might not have been caught. So have you been driving a vehicle without a license? Not today, but when you were younger, did you drive vehicles without your parents, without a license? You were committing offenses. You were all juveniles at that point of time. So some of you said no, but many are saying yes many times. So all those were offenses we were committing, but we did not think of ourselves as juvenile delinquents. Is there some other people out there? You know, we have this very categorization of some other people who commit rape, who commit theft, who commit offenses. But when we violate the law, we the educated ones, we belonging to affluent families, when we do the violation of law, our classification of ourselves is not we were committing offenses and therefore we are juvenile delinquents. I'm not only talking about now age, I'm talking about our actions as well. So if you were apprehended at the age of 16 for speed driving, and if you happen to have, no, we recently had this Mercedes hit and run case in Delhi a couple of years ago. So this boy was driving very, was over speeding in an accident, killed a person. Should he be treated as an adult and tried as an adult? Because he was few days, I mean, in this case, I think he was just 4 days less than 18. So if you happen to be driving fast and you happen to be 16 or 17 or just less than 18, should you be treated as adult and tried similarly? Or should you be treated like a child? But we have only two divisions here. One is children below the age of 18. The other is children above the age, the persons below the, above the age of 18. Above the 18, one set of criminal law applies and another set of laws applies to children below the age of 18. And we will come to this whole question as to what are the offenses we would want to be treated as an adult. So Mrigank says yes, which would be treated as an adult. So I'll come to this again towards the end of my conversation, but I want to do take you very quickly to the whole concept as to why we have this difference for dealing with children. So there have been basically four approaches for dealing with children differently. One we call as the parents patriae approach, which is saying the state will act, will step in the shoes of the parent and we will deal with children in the same manner as our parents would. So our parent at the age of 16, we do not think we're ready to take the consequences. They would try to protect us against all kind of penalties from outside system. So they, within the system also, the state tries to do that. The second concept comes from the concept of mens rea, which says the children do not have sufficiently developed mental intention for them to be held similarly liable. for taking the consequences, taking the same criminal responsibility as adults. The third approach has been welfare. We want to ensure that children grow up into robust citizens of tomorrow, and therefore for their welfare, for their care, because they are not capable of looking after themselves, we should do that. Since 1989, in the international level and at the national levels, we have accepted the approach of rights, which grants children certain more rights than adults. They have all the rights, most of the rights which adults have, but they have some additional rights as well. One of them, for example, is the right to survival and development. The right to education comes from this whole approach, that they have a right to education. It is not only a welfare measure of the state. So this is what I was asking you to do. This I'm not going to play. So this was the question which I've said. But remember, whenever we talk about age cutoff, whether it is 18, whether it is 16, whether it is 14, it is 12, and we do know that in our law, for different purposes, we have got different cutoffs. You are still a child under the Child Marriage Restraint Act till the age of 21 if you are a boy. If you are a girl, you cease to be a child at the age of 18. So we do know that the variation in the age for different purposes have been 7 to 21 years, but in some cases there's been even 0 to 5 and 0 to 6 for Anganwadi, for lots of other things also. You have 0 to 6 is one age group where informal education is being talked about. Because from 6 onward, there's a compulsory primary education, but before that also now we're beginning to talk about that. But at whatever cutoff we put, it is arbitrary. Can you think of a reason why I'm saying it is arbitrary? Any cutoff is arbitrary. Did anyone have a birthday ready recently? So Satish had. So Satish, when you turned, whatever, you turned 19 a few days ago, you were 18 plus a few days ago, now you are 19 plus. Whether anything has changed, anything overnight when you turned 19? All of you, when you became 18, did anything turn
overnight? No, nothing really changed.
You will take full responsibility. So, 2 days before the accident, ho jata, to Juvenile Justice Act lagta, 2 days baad hoga, to IPC lagega. So, law does not recognize the fact that growing up is a gradual process. Nothing starkly happens on that very night when you turn an adult. But when you say 18, when you say 16, law says overnight you will acquire buddhi or you will lose buddhi. And that is the whole issue, whether you are, when you are 2 months less than 21, you can't marry. Two months later, you can marry. Or day before, you can't marry. A day later, you can marry. And nothing else has changed, excepting a legal technicality has happened that you have completed that age. So whatever be the age group, this is going to be a difficulty. And that's the limitation of the law. But that's also the best manner in which law deals with classifications. Because you say, okay, then I will determine an individual case. Do you have sufficient capacity to vote? I can't go on inquiring everybody that I'll have an IQ test, I'll have some independent test. So age is an easy classification category. At the same time, it is an arbitrary classification. And therefore, we need to be aware of it, that whatever the age group we may decide, it is going to be a little problematic on that front. So the rationality for 18, this arbitrary age of 18, is not so arbitrary across the world. We found that majority of people have agreed that 18 is the right kind of an age where you can be made more responsible. So even though individually speaking, nothing much happens at the individual level, but at the legal level, you get a lot more rights. And that has been one of the reasons. And we have Convention on the Rights of the Child, which does say 18 as the definition of child, and which has been accepted in many cases, and we are going to increase that category as well. So this I'll skip on the dolls and brain part of it. And very quickly, because somebody did say I've traced the history, this is a whole range of history, starting from 1850 to 2021. 1850, first time we recognize in case of delinquent category, we recognize that sending children to prison is not a good thing. And therefore we said we will give them into trainings for petty offenders below the age of 15. Then there was a proposal to create separate institutions for them. At that point of time, British government said, oh, Indians are very evil and very calculative. They would want free education and residence for their children. So therefore give them whipping, not residences. But then 1898, they changed their mind and we created reformatories to say all children should not be sent to jail. Some of them, which are bright ones, had a good future, they can be sent to the reformatory schools. 1920 saw a major break from the criminal justice system with the Children Acts coming into force, beginning with Madras, Bombay, Bengal following, and which kind of completely segregated the two systems. Separate juvenile court also came in. So we have separate juvenile court, we have separate remand home, separate procedures. So lots of things changed. And a lot of rights also got lost, which were available to them in the criminal justice system. One of the major rights which they lost was a right to a lawyer. Then every state, there were about 8 states at the time we got the Children Act 1960, and it made a major change, again, shift, saying no imprisonment to any child under any circumstance, not even to police station. The definition also became sex-based, 16 for boys, 18 for girls, for the protection of girls. And I'm not going into more any more details. We also got 2 sets of institutions there. Before that, we had only one court dealing with both categories of children, delinquent and neglected. But in 1960, we created 2 separate adjudicatory bodies, known from different names and different legislations today. They're known as Juvenile Justice Board to deal with children in conflict with law, and Child Welfare Committee to deal with children in need of care protection. This is CCL and CNCP. Earlier words were delinquents and neglected. So 1960 was a model legislation, but still every state was having their own. Model legislation was applicable to union territories. Then there was a Sheila Barsack case, and we got to a point where court said, no, this is very discriminatory because the laws were very different. The pre-independence legislations provided for some kind of imprisonment. Post-legislation, post-1947, all the laws which were created followed the 1960 Act, and they provided for no imprisonment. So the court said, no, you get a legislation, central legislation. And before that, in 1960, it was not found to be suitable because the entries in the Constitution did not permit this as a central subject. In 1986, no question asked, Supreme Court direction, and we got a law. Definition continued. It followed more or less the 1960 pattern. Then we got the 2000 legislation, and we got a title change. Remember, also the title change was there. We were calling the Children Act till 1986. Then it came to Juvenile Justice Act. Then there was criticism that you can't call them juvenile, so we got a children. Juvenile Justice, it's a wrong writing here. Juvenile Justice, Care and Protection of Children Act. So that's what the full name, that the emphasis was, it is on care and protection. And then the age was changed to 18 years. That was changed to, 18 years was changed because we had the CRC direction that we have to be in consonance with that, having signed that. So we got that 18. Then we know that after Nirbhaya, there was a whole lot of halabaloo about this legislation. It is letting children go free, committing serious offenses. And we got the 2015 legislation, which kept the cutoff age as 18, but provided for selective transfer of some children between the age of 16 to 18 to adult courts called the Children Court, in case they have been alleged to have committed a heinous offense. I'll come to the little more detail on that one. And now in 2021, we have got 2 major amendments in the legislation. A major minor thing, but 2 major. One relating to the definition of heinous offense. The categorized, not heinous offense, actually special. Serious offenses. And the other relating to adoption. So the standard misunderstanding
regarding response to crime has been this whole thing about that Juvenile Justice Act permissive, does nothing, comes because we do not punish them. You do not punish them, you let them go. But that's a very simplistic understanding of response to crime. One can understand it into four social discipline windows. The one window is known as the punitive window, which we all expect is justice when somebody commits an offense. It is high on control, but very little on support. I'll hide this here. There are two axes. One is the axis of control, the other is the axis of support. So the punitive approach is very high on control and zero on support. It only puts them into the prisons as if they're never going to come out, and that's the end of justice. The third window, the second window I would want to focus is the neglectful, which is neither control nor support. So when your parents turned a blind eye when you were driving a vehicle or even encouraged you to do that, that will be the permissive category. It is high on support, less on control. But all the children who are found on the roads, this boy in Nirbhaya case was also neglected for 6 long years. Nobody knew he was dead or alive. We came to his existence when he committed this heinous offense. Before that, nobody bothered what was the guide, what was the company, where he was growing up. There was neither support nor control over that child for long 6 years. So at the age of 17, he committed this very serious barbaric offense. And then we're all asking for his head, not realizing that why did he turn into that barbaric monster at the age of 17? Permissive is one good example of the Delhi hit and run case where the 17 plus boy has run over somebody and his father went out of his way, he's gone right to the Supreme Court to get an order in his favor so that he is not tried as an adult. Restorative is both on high on control and high on support. We work with children in that and not against them. So this is punitive, is we do something to them, we do nothing for them, we do something for them, and in restorative we say we work with them. And that's the approach which Juvenile Justice Act does provide us for, but we are, most of us are not aware of that. So in this one, we do look at, we believe that this legislation is for punishing children, but look at these objectives. Nowhere punishment is the objective. It continues to be to provide care and protection, to secure best interests of children, for rehabilitation of children. So the purpose hasn't changed, but the impression is that this is a legislation provided for punishment of children now. The general principles are like fundamental rights and directive principles, but these are fundamental and they're all talking about protection of children, no somatization, identity, all kinds of things which are for the children. And these have to be followed by all agencies, all bodies created functioning under this legislation. So coming back to the categorization, I said we have got two categories, CNCP, and the body to deal with them is CWC. The other one group is CCL, Children in Conflict with Law, and the body to deal with them are these two. Now is the question time. So the question time, my first question is, do we know how many children we have in India? Any guesstimates, estimates, knowledge? 472 million, perfect. How many? Okay, that's a good one. 472 million. Next question. How many of them are CNCP? Children in need of care and protection. All. That's not correct. When you were a child, were you a CNCP? 172 million. Where is my slide? My figure says 36 million. And we know these are all guesstimates. We do not actually have any figures to tell us how many children in India need care. But these are guesstimates based on the categorization we have. There are about 10 categories defining who is a CNCP, which includes orphan, children exploited sexually otherwise, children in catastrophe, So there are lots of categories there. How many of them, not of them, of the total children in India, you think are the children who have committed an offense or have been, you know, what is your latest figures or the about how many children out of this 472 million? Yeah, so Neha Sharma is right that we do not have official categorization, but these are guesstimates of the government itself also. But we have a proper official figure on CCL. How many children in conflict with law? What's your sense? How many children out of 1 lakh children are involved in offenses? What will be your sense? Ten percent, 3%. You're talking percent and I'm asking you lakhs. Okay, so when you say percent, so out of lakh kitne hoga 10,000 if you say 10%. 10,000 hua na? Oh, we have a Ved Kumar also here. Okay, so let me give you the official figures. This is not in million, this is only 32,235 children against whom cases were registered. No, these are not even the cases, this is only the cases registered. 32,235. Do you have any sense of how many children are there in USA? I'll give you this figure, 73 million. I'm also giving you the figure, how many children in USA are CCL, arrested for an offense? It's 2.1 million. Okay. Now my last question. Okay, this also you may not know. Rate of crime in India says, and when I'm talking about rate of crime in India, I'm talking about the adult crime. That out of 1 lakh people, how many people may have been charged with an offense, may have been arrested for an offense? Do you have any sense of that? This is not in thousands. This is only the total figure. Out of 1 lakh, our rate of crime is 241 human beings. Out of 1 lakh human beings, Indian, we have only 241 people arrested for any offense. And remember, 66% of these offenses are property-related offenses, majority of them petty theft cases. What is your sense of, looking at these figures, what is the rate of juvenile delinquency in India? How many children out of 1 lakh children may have been charged or may have been arrested for an offense, arrested or there have been a case filed against them? And if you're talking about all IPC, local and special laws included, 10 to 20 children per lakh, 100, 10%, below 500, 200. Certainly tells us that as students of law, you need to look at the facts and figures. You've got no sense of what is juvenile delinquency about, how many children commit offenses. We all go by the newspaper reports. 7.2 is your average rate of juvenile delinquency in India. So you can see that the rate of crime in USA, rate of juvenile delinquency is coming to more than 14 on an average, while for us it is half than that. And that is when we have got so many more children. Yes, please. Somebody was saying something? Okay, so let's move to this. So somewhere I wanted to also understand that when you look at the total number of children who require care for having committed any offense, and again, in case of children also, petty offenses are the majority of offenses. Even the 66% is an average around the years, over the years, where it is petty theft offenses, petty offenses against property. So 32,000 is not even the murderers and the rapists that we think about. The children's crime is increasing. We need to change the law and all that. It's all coming from newspapers, not from the facts on ground. In case of CWCP and CNCP, we said CWC was the category. And these are the various orders which can be passed in relation to them. But most of our, you know, and going back again, see this one. When we look at CNCP, it's 36 million compared to 32,000. But we don't end up talking about Juvenile Justice Act implementation and efficacy in relation to 36 million. The only conversation we end up doing is 32,000. And that too with so much horror that how can they be let free, even though we know they are not being let free. There's a whole system in place. So here are the various orders. Major change has happened in relation to adoptions. We know that there's an adoption court, and adoption has been permissible only to Hindus. Of course, in the Juvenile Justice Act, we have provided for adoption of all CNCP and CCL children as well. And therefore, any child falling in that category can also be given an adoption through the formal process. HAMA is limited, Hindu marriage, Hindu Maintenance and Adoption Act is limited to Hindus, but under the Juvenile Justice Act, adoption is also permissible. And now the whole scheme has been taken from away from the courts by the minister's belief. We say belief because that's not the truth, that it will expedite. If the district magistrates will do it, it will happen quickly and children need homes. This is a controversial category and I don't have time for going there. A new term has come into operation, COVID orphans. Orphans was always a CNCP category, but now COVID orphans are being treated separately compared to the other CNCP. And that's also very problematic. And again, I'm just flagging it, not spending time. The other thing which has, is the other stream is the CCL. And we know there were two categories. Below 16, they commit any offense, order under 18. If they are 16 to 18, only petty and serious offenses under section 18. But if it is 16 to 18 years and they committed a heinous offense, then preliminary assessment to be done. Not all of them are to be transferred, but some of them may be selectively transferred to the children's court. The which court is also to do a repeat assessment and then dispose it of either as children or as an adult. There's also a scheme which is now under a lot of challenge because many judicial officers think that if it's a serious offense, 16 to 18, automatically, mechanically transfer. So that's a major violation happening on the ground. Going by the watch, I think I'll just run, I could present it to you. You can look at that, but I'm not going to spend time there. I don't have that time. So what I do want to spend a couple of minutes is the special features. One of the very important special features has been that every child, whether 16 to 18, serious offense, heinous offense, whatever, or other petty offenses, younger children, they have to be granted bail irrespective of the classification of bailable and non-bailable offenses in CRPC. Only three conditions are listed there when you can deny bail. If the child is likely to, if the release will bring the child to in contact with known criminals, expose him to moral danger, or it be against the interest of justice. And the second one has also been the disqualification, which has now been, exception has been granted if it's a child, the records will not be destroyed if the offense is a heinous offense. So the first challenge has been, of course, age determination, but that's the only thing. They have to be above 16, below 18, and we know that majority of these children who come into the system do not have any age proof. So it happens by, there is a sequence, section 94 of the legislation does provide for the procedure. And the third option is that if no other documentary evidence available, then one can go for medical examination, which gives you a variation of 2 years plus minus. There has been this direction prior to this current legislation saying the benefit should go in their favor. Then there are these preliminary assessments. Again, I don't think if you're not doing anything specialized on this one, you just need to know that there has to be a preliminary assessment, finding out about their capacity, etc. But we know there are a lot of limitations and there are a lot of violations of the rights of the children also happening. The crucial part is this one. These were the three categories, these are the original definitions in the 2015 legislation. So tell me, now is the question time. Tell me, if you are the person driving the vehicle, what do you call them as rash and negligently, and think of that boy in Delhi who was driving a Mercedes and then over a person, he was charged with section 304, not 304A. But I'll ask you the same question. So if you are charged with murder, if a child is charged with murder and the child is 17 years old, what will be the nature of his offense? Will it be heinous, petty, or serious? Look at the definition and tell me. Heinous, perfectly. If you are charged with 304, which is culpable homicide not amounting to murder, what will be the offense? Will it be heinous, petty, or serious? As per this definition, which is in front of you. So you're writing serious. By this definition, why will that be a serious offense? Because the offense of 304 is punishable with imprisonment of life or imprisonment up to 10 years. So why would you say it was a serious offense? The serious offense definition says offenses for which punishment under IPC or other law is imprisonment between 3 to 7 years. Does it include offenses up to 10 years? So why would 304 be classified as serious? And that was the dilemma which was found for, faced by the judges. I, of course, in my book in 2016 itself, had taken the position that it will be classified as serious because of the juvenile justice provision, the approach of the juvenile justice, because of the limited interpretation of the criminal law, which is a strict interpretation. Because if you say heinous, then the liability, criminal liability of the person increases. But we had, at that point of time, difference of opinion among the judicial officers. Some of them treated as serious, some of them treated as heinous. And the Delhi Mercedes case, the Delhi Juvenile Justice Board did treat it as a heinous one and sent it to the High Court. High Court said, no, it was not heinous. It was a serious offense. The matter went up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court also said that there is a fourth category of offenses which are not included in these three. So now the definition has been modified and we have a new definition which does clarify that these kind of offenses will be. So there's no change in the heinous and petty offenses, but serious offenses have been redefined to include the fourth category which was left out as serious offense. So therefore, somebody committing a child of 17 committing 304 offense will not be, or robbery, dacoity kind of offenses which are punishable with 10 years, will not come. Even if it's life imprisonment, they will not come in heinous category. Because what is essential is the word which we were talking about earlier in heinous offenses. It should be, the offense should provide for minimum imprisonment of 7 years or more. If there's no minimum imprisonment provided, which is a case in 304, that there's no minimum provided. It's up to 10 years, maybe life as well. But it is not saying minimum this has to be given. And therefore, all offenses which may have life imprisonment as one of the options will also not be heinous offense. These are the various orders. And have a quick look at these. So home, release to fit institution, fit facility, person, fine, community service, group counseling, advice or management. Very quickly, remember this. Because I'm going to give you a problem. And then I'm going to ask you what should be the order which should be passed in this case. These are some additional orders. School jao, training karo, whatever, no, therapeutic centers, etc., etc. Order that cannot be passed is death penalty and life imprisonment without the possibility of release. This punishment didn't exist earlier, but since amendments started happening in the offense of rape, it has started happening. If anyone of you have seen this report in the newspapers, this was up in the bold letters, and it's all are misreporting. If you believe this, then you have not looked at the original case. I'll come back to it if the question arises. Now, this is the situation. I'm talking about you. Assume you are 17-year-old and have been having sex with a 16-year-old girlfriend with her consent, including her parents' consent. So my first question, should you be charged with any offense? It's not rape. Yes. What offense should you be charged with?
Poxo.
Poxo may. So if you should be charged with offense, that is called sexual, penetrative sexual assault. So you're charged with, you know, this is equivalent, the definition of penetrative sexual assault is the same as is found in the IPC, the offense of rape. So if you're 17 years old, you are having consensual sex with a girlfriend with her consent and her parents' consent, you are now charged with rape. Who says according to IPC is not rape? The definition, you compare the two definitions, they're just the same. The only difference is that in the IPC, it is a man who does it to a woman. In this legislation, it can be either man or woman having sex with the other is liable for rape. Well, the term used is not rape, the term used is different, but the substance of the offense is the same. So going further, one is this question. So if you're 19-year-old and the rest of the things remain the same, then your section changes or the section remains the same. Then is it rape or is it not rape? So then it becomes
rape. If the girl is below 18, then it is rape because they are considered not mature enough to give permission for any sexual act.
Right. So whether it is, are you saying that in the first instance, the offense of rape will not be charged against this boy of 17 years old? Only POXO will apply, IPC will not apply to this man?
No, ma'am, in both the cases. In both the cases, the same.
Yeah. The same. Okay. If you are 17 years and your girlfriend is 19 years old, rest of the things are the same.
Then depends on the consent of the girl.
Oh, girl to consent kar rahi hai. Dekh, main girl consent kar rahi hai. Girl ki consent ka issue nahi hai.
But then if complaint happens, then depends on the situation, ma'am, because the boy is a minor.
It is the girl's father hamesha jo complain karta hai na, wo girls ke father karte hain.
Ji.
Haan, to isme batao, isme kya hoga? You're a 17-year-old boy and your girlfriend is 19 years old. Who is liable for the offense?
In this case, the boy is a minor, so probably the girl can be charged. There can be a cross FIR from the boy's parents' side.
It can be the boy can be charged under juvenile justice and can be considered a child in conflict with law.
Why is he not a victim? Why is he an offender? Why is not a CNCP?
He can be considered as a, ma'am, even the CCL can be considered as CNCP.
No, but is this 17-year-old by CCL at all?
No, that only depends, ma'am. If there is a cross FIR, then the girl can be booked as well because
even
the
if there is no cross FIR, even if there's no cross FIR.
Ma'am, then if it is a consensual act and the magistrate feels that it is, there is no point of coercion or any other violence, then
if the 16-year-old girl was not presumed to have the capacity to give consent, the 17-year-old boy presumed to have the capacity to give consent.
That's the problem of the law, ma'am. That's actually the.
Ma'am, the minor can't give the consent, right?
Minors are not.
Yeah, so they're not given able to give consent.
Yeah.
Then is there still any doubt whether 17-year-old boy is CNCP or CCA? Whether any of these people, whoever you consider is the offender, should they be given bail?
Yes, ma'am. Bail, I think, should be granted. If it is a consensual act, if both have done it consensually, in many of the cases, even the bails are granted as well.
Yeah, but nowadays, boys are not being given bail under the Juvenile Justice Act. And that is what news clip I was showing, projected. Of course, that's a wrong projection by the news clip. But that was the impression created that it has been refused. So if you think in all these cases, bail should be granted?
I think so, ma'am. If the act is consensual, though the law is black and white, that is another thing. But if the act is consensual, then I think the bail should be granted. And yeah. I think the prerogative
Listen. The punishment for this offense, even though it's a statutory offense, is minimum 10 years, no exceptions. Do you think your lady is on bail, he'll come back for trial? Or she will come back for trial? And these are the facts.
The
yeah, but that's what the law says, no? I'm just trying to project to you the resistance we have to honoring the law when it comes to people like us. We do not want the law. We say the law is incorrect. Law is wrong. We should not. Now, how can the law be that? But that is what the law is today. And we're all wanting to resist that. That resistance doesn't come. When that boy in the street who has been neglected all his life commits an offense, whether consensual or non-consensual. Talwar's case, this whole the film Talwar, we do not know what the truth is, but the established truth is, as the film projects, or what the judgments say, who were the parties involved? There was no resistance from the girl for whatever was happening. Murder charge. We do not accept these third parties. Do you know how many people, what are the percentage of cases where the offender is not known to the parties? It is a stranger. What percentage of cases? 6%, perfect. 94%, as per the report, are people known to the victim. So it's only 6% which are strangers, but we fear rape from the strangers. So when it comes to this category of our people, my boyfriend, my girlfriend being charged, we do not want to honor the law. We think the law is wrong because we will be put behind bars. But we want everybody else, every other child who is usually the subject, who has been traditionally subject matter of law, to be hanged, to be sent to prison, never to come out. All those kinds of things came from that perspective. So there's a very huge bias we have in favor of the activity we consider, we commit, and what the others say. So in disposal, if the case is 17-year-old, should this child be now sent to the juvenile court to be tried as an adult? The moment you do that, and lots of the judges are doing that today, they send it to the adult court, and then the adult court, the moment adult court deals with it, should they now try this person under the Juvenile Justice Act provision and dispose of under Juvenile Justice Act, or should they be giving the punishment under the IPC?
I'm here on the section 15, which requires a preliminary assessment of.
The judge's attitude nowadays here also we're talking about, and now it's the experience from most places that the JJBs do not maintain, but the judges are not doing that because the sense is if you're tried as an adult, the adult law will apply. It all happened because of the way we think of children. So I'm going back and I'm going to stop at that and let you, if you want any more questions, clarification you want to raise about that, the whole perception of who's a child. And also, you know, coming back to this also, 17-year-old boy and a girl of 19, police automatically, the JJB automatically will charge the 17-year-old boy as CCL. But he's a victim. Even in the first case, the 17-year-old boy and the 16-year-old girl, who is the offender? Is there any offender in this case?
No. Doesn't look like.
Yeah, but it automatically translates into, in the actual practice, the boy is treated as CCL, the girl is treated as victim.
Yes, ma'am, usually it happens.
She is sent to the CWC, he is sent to the JJB. Even though the popularization is gender neutral. So we are not changing our mental images. We are not progressing with the time. We are not accepting that there is a change in the criminal law policy. Juvenile justice is a different branch of law. Children have a different future. In case of children, you cannot look back. You have to look forward. They have a whole life in front of them. You send a 17-year-old to the, in the initial place, to the special home, what you call place of safety. The child remains there till the age of 21. Then you send him to jail. So then he comes out of jail after 10 years. So at the age of 27, what do you think will this person be like? Will be an honest citizen of this country? Is he more likely to become a criminal? Is he likely to have a future? Will he be able to earn his livelihood? Will he be able to have a family, marry someone? He or she, that may be either way. So we are destroying a whole 65 years of the future by sending those children to this adult system in the name of security today. But in the, without thinking about what happened in the future to this one. And in these years, from 17 years old till 21, he will be in the company of other children who have also committed heinous offenses. So if all of them come together and grow up together, do you think they're going to get reformed? Our institutions are so well equipped that we will provide individualized care. This is what I expected of law. Is it really going to happen on the ground? That we will have individualized care, we will ensure that each one of them reforms, and it is not for punishment, for reforming and all that. I think we really need to rethink as to the direction in which this law is going. I'm stopping at that. And if you have any questions, you're very welcome to ask.
Ma'am, I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Ma'am, in the cases where you mentioned this, both the parties are minors, in these cases, why there is not a, there's no practice of cross FIR? Like even the girls, the boys' family can also file an FIR.
There are some, these are exceptional categories. So we had a case actually in which the adult woman of 30 years mm-hmm. filed a case of rape against a child. And she said that, no, he has been blackmailing, blah, blah, blah. So the judge did say in that case that you are the experienced woman, he is a young man. And therefore the judge said that, no, the case, there was no cross FIR, but the court took cognizance of that fact that this is a boy, actually he is the victimized child.
Ma'am, in
but that is an exceptional category. You do not find those cases on the run of the mill.
But ma'am, if both the parties are minor and the girl's father, for example, lodges an FIR, why the boy's family is not usually following the practice of lodging the cross
FIR? They also believe ladke hi karte hain sab gadbad, aur hamara IP se to kehta hai ladka only can do this na.
So ma'am, this works on perception, or do we have a technical thing to stop that?
No, nothing technical about
it. Okay, so then that means it works on
personal. We've done so many trainings of judges mm-hmm. and constantly this example, haan, ladka JJB hai, ladki CJB hai, kyun? Either both of them are victims or both of them are offenders.
Yes, ma'am. Mostly, even while my experience of working with the JJB people, the boys are usually minors and girls are sent to CWC, even if consensual, and borderline minors only.
For run an elopement or love cases, toh aajkal run out of mail ho gaya na. And now it is pinching us. So then we want any protection, we should be there.
So there is no technicality per se to stop it, just the perception works.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because they don't rely that it is a gender neutral law.
Yeah.
When I tell them it's a gender neutral, so therefore the girl can also, when somebody said, no, in the case of 19-year-old girl, I'm to sochte rapist girl ho sakti hai, tumhari to terminology nahi hai wo wali.
Ji.
So that's the whole issue.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you for the prizing speech, ma'am. If you permit, we may open the floor for more questions. Okay, now I would like to invite Ms. Gitanjali Ghosh, Assistant Professor of Law and Coordinator of Center of Child Rights at Naluja, to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the very outset, I would like to offer my heartfelt gratitude to Professor Ved Kumari for gracing our university again, albeit in the online mode. And ma'am, thank you so much for raising such pertinent questions regarding the Juvenile Justice Act of 2015. And trust me, as many lectures that I have delivered, this is a continuous question as to what happens when both the boy and girl are a minor and have had consensual sexual intercourse. What do we do? And things get even worse when they run away and get married. So thank you so much for pointing out, if I may say so, a very, very gray area in the law, which is possibly right now only in the hands of the judiciary and later in the hands of the legislators to rectify. Thank you so much, ma'am. It's always a pleasure to listen to you. And thank you. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to come to our university and deliver this lecture.
My pleasure.
I will be failing in my duty if I do not extend my thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor V.K. Ahuja, for his constant and undeniable support and encouragement at all points in time. We need only ask, and sir always says, yes, beta, go ahead. I'm also very thankful to Dr. Madhulika Janathan, Chief of Field Office, UNICEF Assam and Northeast, for her constant support and encouragement. I can definitely not do without thanking Lakshmi Narayan Nanda, sir. Lakshmi, sir, you have always been there encouraging us, guiding us as to how to go about things. And I'm pretty sure that the talks we have now initiated about, reinvigorating our partnership, we will really have fruitful results. So thank you so much, sir, for always being there. I am also very, very thankful to the registrar of our university, Dr. Indranoshi Das, for giving us all the support that we need from the university. I also extend my heartfelt thanks to our assistant registrar academics, Dr. Nandrani Chaudhary, for again, always being there, and we need only ask her. I'm also very thankful to the systems department of our university, particularly Satyajit, for being there and troubleshooting all our technical difficulties. I, of course, have to extend my thanks to all the participants who have given a patient hearing to ma'am today and have raised such pertinent questions that has only elevated the status of this lecture. And last but not the least, how can I forget our student volunteers? I know you have had a day long of classes. I know you want to rest, but even then you have taken out time and have been so passionate about helping us out at the center. Without you students, trust me, things will not go anywhere. So with these words, I, on behalf of Team CCR and my fellow co-coordinators, Mr. Himanshu Ranjan Nath and Ms. Priti Priyam Sharma, extend a very, very warm and heartfelt thanks to everybody who has been a part of today's lecture. And I hope that you shall be a part of future lectures that will be organized by CCR as we plan to make this a monthly event. And who better than Professor Ved Kumari to have delivered the inaugural lecture, if I may say so, of this series of lectures. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Yeah. Bye. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much, ma'am.
You're very welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor.
Thank you, Vijay Nakaraj.